HarperCollins and Harper Audio present The Wise Women, a novel by Gina Sorell. Performed by Stacey Glemboski. A wise woman knows that the biggest investment she can make in her marriage is her husband. Wendy Wise. Just make sure your husband isn't a liar. Clementine Wise.
Who needs a husband?
Barb Wise.
1. Summer. Queens, New York. 2017.
Nothing says, I do, like real estate. Not diamonds, not a fancy white dress you'll wear only once, not a party that eats up all your savings in a single day. No, nothing says, I want a future with you, like owning a place together and building your love one square foot at a time. Together, a house becomes a home, and with it, the security that comes with knowing that you've invested in one another.
Just make sure you're there on the day the deal is done, or else you might be in for a nasty surprise. And whose fault would that be? Yours, dummy. That's who.
The old house was a sweatbox in the summer. The heat, along with Clementine's frustration, trapped inside. Clementine was waiting for Steve to get back from one of his endless brainstorming retreats. Yet another one for the carbonated vegetable water idea that wouldn't die. So she could ask him why the man he'd promised to call about the ductless air conditioning on the second floor had never showed up. And, what's more, why Steve hadn't answered any of her texts. It was the third time the unit had broken down, and her patience had run out. Clementine heard the screen door open and walked down the stairs as fast as she could, ready to have it out. But when she looked through the little lace curtain that covered the glass window on the door, she was shocked to see not Steve, but Mr. Gregoris, the house's former owner, standing in the sun and pressing the doorbell that no longer worked.
"Mr. Gregoris," she said, opening the door wide. "How are you? How's life in the Greek islands?"
"Well, well, thank you, Miss Clementine," he said as he stepped inside. "We are just back for a visit. My granddaughter's christening."
"Wow, another grandchild. Congratulations."
"Here it comes," she thought. "The talk about children. Plural."
"Yes, well, you know it's good for kids to have a sibling."
There it was. She was tired of having to explain that having only one child felt right for her. It's not like they were shoes. You didn't have to have a pair. But she knew he wouldn't let it go unless she gave him an answer he couldn't argue with, so she said, "Ah, yes. Well, we're stopping at one. Better for the environment, carbon footprint and all that. At this rate, we're probably going to run out of water, so..."
"Climate change."
His tone made it clear he wasn't a believer. But instead of having the same conversation they'd had so many times before, he handed her a small plate of cookies covered in icing sugar.
"My wife made these for Jonah. She remembered how much he likes them."
The cookies were indeed a favorite of Jonah's. He'd bought nearly the entire plate of them from Mrs. Gregoris at a Christmas bazaar one year. Clementine knew he'd be thrilled to see them when he got home from YMCA day camp.
"You got the oven on?"
Mr. Gregoris asked. "No, the AC unit is broken." Clementine wondered if that's what he thought she did all day, stood and cooked. Besides, cooking is Steve's job. Mr. Gregoris started to frown.
"Is he home?"
"No, not yet. Soon. Why?"
She wondered if he was back to collect something he'd hidden deep in the basement. So far, they'd found an old photo album, some war medals belonging to his late relatives, and his grandmother's brooch. Steve had suggested to Mr. Gregoris that maybe a safety deposit box would be a good idea.
I should talk to him.
You can talk to me.
It's better I talk to your husband, Miss Clementine. It's about money.
She didn't think it was possible, but she felt herself get even hotter. She reminded herself that he wasn't trying to insult her. It was a cultural thing, a generational thing, a mind-numbingly frustrating thing. He looked around the house and nodded appreciatively.
You've done a very good job keeping the place nice, Miss Clementine.
Thank you, she said, choosing to rise above her indignation. I love this house, you know that, and I'm so grateful to be living here. She meant it. In spite of their differences, she liked Mr. Gregoris, and often wondered if he regretted the private sale he'd done with her, given he could have gotten so much more for it now. She was sure his greedy breeding children did, even though they'd had no desire to live in the less hip, less cool, family-friendly neighborhood of Sunnyside, Queens, and had settled in Brooklyn, Park Slope, of course, instead. The only thing they wanted from their father was for him to sell the house to someone who would overpay for a chance to do a gut reno on a home in the garden community. But Mr. Gregoris had no interest in having someone gut the first home he'd bought in America, the wedding present he'd given his new bride, Anastasia, who'd joined him 5 years after they'd gotten engaged in Athens. It was the place where they'd raised two beautiful children into the ungrateful, spoiled adults they were today. Too spoiled to appreciate the little house with crooked floors and a front hall light that flashed when the doorbell rang, and radiators that sang to one another in the winter, calling, "You can do it!" to each other from room to room as the house slowly heated up. He'd offered to do a private sale with Clementine and Steve. After listening to Clementine talk endlessly about how much she'd love to own a house one day instead of renting the one-bedroom apartment he owned above his store. For years, Clementine had dreamed of being a homeowner, of having enough room for a home office for her fledgling marketing firm, On Your Mark, and space for Jonah to grow and play. It had seemed impossible with the way the market was going, house prices rapidly rising, and multiple buyers bidding on places the day they went on sale. Clementine knew enough from her architect sister Barb and her own work writing copy for a real estate development company that the city showed no signs of slowing down. If she hadn't jumped at the chance to do a private sale with Mr. Gregoris, her dreams of home ownership might never have become a reality. The house turned out to be everything Clementine had hoped. It was close enough to her sister Barb in Brooklyn, and not too far from her mother in Manhattan. Yes, it was old, and the floors creaked so loudly that it was impossible to be heard if you walked and talked at the same time. But it had good bones and a strong foundation, and was part of the historic Sunnyside Gardens, the first planned urban community in America. Clementine's backyard not only backed on to a gorgeous common space that felt like a magical oasis, but it also had the community's only treehouse, a deviation from the current bylaws that her neighbors overlooked, being fond of Jonah and his love of the little treetop home. Besides lending them the balance of the down payment, Barb had designed the treehouse in the massive London plane tree to be the coolest any child had ever seen, with a rope swing and ladder that climbed through a series of lookout decks in the lower branches until it finally reached a little wooden house that was high enough to see across the block. It was where Jonah went every day after school and on the weekends, and if he'd been allowed to live there, he would have moved right in. With its beautiful parks, mom-and-pop shops, and terrific public schools, Sunnyside had seen the value of its homes increase at a dizzying rate. For once,
Clementine had been ahead of the curve. It had taken all of their savings. Well, all of her savings, if she was being honest. Every single dollar she had, and some of Barb's, after Wendy had declined to help with the down payment in favor of her retirement portfolio. The fact that Clementine couldn't do it entirely on her own would only have given Steve more ammunition to say no, so she never told him. He'd been so against the idea, still in business school, and talking about using their money for his new startup. But knowing that he didn't really have a say because he wasn't contributing financially, he'd had no choice but to go along. And in an effort to soothe his ego, Clementine recalled the words of her mother, Wendy, the famed advice columnist of Wise Words. "It's okay to be the breadwinner, as long as your husband thinks he's the bread baker." And told Steve she thought it would be best if he handled the money from now on. "You've always been better with numbers than I have, and we'll need your business sense for a private sale." They'd invest in his business next time. This time, they were doing what was best for Jonah. Having more space and not being on top of each other all the time actually helped their marriage at first. With Jonah being in school, they'd work in separate parts of the house and meet in the kitchen for lunch or on the back deck and talk about what they were doing. Occasionally, they'd even share a beer, and Clementine would listen as Steve told her about his idea to reinvent the whole sparkling water space, his excitement and desire for her to share in it, reminiscent of when they first met. He cared about what she thought of his ideas and wanted her to believe in them as much as he did, and she loved how much her opinion mattered. Sometimes, if Steve was having a particularly great day and she could spare the time, they'd sneak upstairs after lunch and make love. And afterward, they'd lie together naked, and Clementine would talk about all the things she wanted to do to the house when they could afford it, while Steve twirled his fingers through her long brown curls. For the first few months, she was almost giddy at the fact that she'd been able to pull it off, and would often wander from room to room and marvel at her good fortune. They had moved just in time for Jonah to start kindergarten at PS 150, the elementary school with Mr. Nettler, the fantastic kindergarten teacher she'd been told would be perfect for Jonah. The one his preschool teacher said got kids with different learning styles or exceptional abilities. Jonah's interest in things, be they dinosaurs, sharks, or understanding the meaning of a turn of phrase, could border on obsessive. Empathetic and deeply thoughtful, he was prone to perseverating over the tiniest of problems. He didn't like surprises, or too much noise, or people who didn't play by the rules. Clementine understood from speaking with a child therapist that not only was Jonah exceptionally bright, with a big, beautiful heart, but that he also had anxiety, and she did her best to help him manage it. But that was easier to do at home than it was in a classroom of six-year-olds. So when Jonah had some trouble fitting into first grade with the other kids, the school responded by suggesting he participate in a new pilot program they were starting in the fall that would be taught by Mr. Nettler. It was for exceptionally bright kids like Jonah, who they felt might benefit from a smaller classroom and student-led project-based learning. The school already had a gifted program and an arts program, and Clementine was hopeful that this new program would take hold and be just what Jonah needed. Unlike Steve, who thought that she worried too much and that Jonah would be fine wherever he went. Clementine didn't want fine for Jonah. She wanted the best. "Miss Clementine," Mr. Gregoris said, interrupting her thoughts and motioning for her to sit while he slowly lowered himself into one of the chairs at the old pine table she'd painted bright white and yellow.
"Is everything?" We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.